Chapter 9. Indy, you just cannot keep piling weight onto this machine. Cromwell became ever more agitated at Indy's seeming indifference. I'm serious, Indy. We're already well above the permissible gross weight. Indy waved Cromwell to silence. As you would say, Will, bosh and bother. Gale grinned at his choice of words and Indy acknowledged her compliment with a slight bow. I may not be a pilot, but I know the mathematics of flight, he continued with Cromwell. Your figures are for a commercial model with specific restrictions, right? And they're for the engines without our superchargers or the fat blades, right? Well, yes, but... But me no buts, my friend. I've worked out the wing loading, power loading, the shift and center of gravity, all that stuff. All that stuff, he calls it, Cromwell complained to Fulwa. He studied Indy carefully. I thought you said you're not a pilot. I'm not. Yet. But numbers are numbers, Will. We've still got the power and lift to handle another 2,000 or 3,000 pounds. And she'll fly like a sodding brick, Cromwell shouted. Tish and blather. What? You sound like a charwoman down on the docks. Get ready to fly, both of you, Indy ordered. We're going down to that restricted area. I want to test out the additional equipment we've added to this thing. Tarkis pushed closer, anticipation stamped on his face. We fire guns. We do, Indy told him. The works. And I want to test those wing shackles for the tanks too. We could hang bombs instead of fuel tanks externally, couldn't we? Bombs? Cromwell groaned, then shook his head in defeat. Yes, yes, we could. Isn't that what you did with those clunker boats you flew in the war? Indy demanded. That was different, Cromwell sniffed. Why? Because it was a bloody war, that's why. And you took chances. What do you think we're getting into? Indy asked quietly. Tea and crumpets. We may need every piece of hardware this thing can carry. And, by the way, every chance we have, I want you to teach me and Gale how to handle this airplane. There'll be times when we can spell you and Renee on a long flight. All we need to do is hold her steady on course. Shouldn't be too difficult. Nothing to it, right? Cromwell said sarcastically. That's the spirit. Load up. Let's go. Henshaw has closed the firing range to everyone but us. They climbed into the airplane, now painted with new lettering and numbers. Gone were the army stars and tail numbers. Blue and red stripes adorned the upper and lower fuselage, and in between were the large letters reading, Global Trans Air. For the record, we're checking out routes for our airliners. How many planes do we have? Fulwa laughed. One, Indy replied. Let's go. I'm going to stand behind you two flyboys and start learning how to handle this thing. You want to start from the ground up, right? Right, Indy said. Good, Fulwa smiled. So you start with a walk-around inspection. You will learn to look for popped rivets, any twist or malformation of metal. Come along, Indy, you learn as we go through the checklist. And you check the fuel by dipstick, because such instruments as fuel gauges are not to be trusted. The same with the oil. They started at the left engine, inspecting fasteners, the wheels and tires, looking for signs of leaking hydraulic fluid. Check the propeller blades for nicks or damage. Ah, look carefully at the propeller fastenings. And while we walk, you check the external control cables. Look for slack or cable wear. Check the oil coolers to be certain they are clear. And, over here, we drain fuel from each tank to get rid of any water that has collected from condensation. When they were through, Tarkis emerged from the cabin with a large fire extinguisher. He'll stand to the side of each engine when we start, Cromwell said. We may not always have time to do it this way, but whenever we can, we follow the book. If there's a fire, he can douse it at once. All right, inside we go. Wait. We won't go anywhere with those chocks by the wheels. Remove them. And don't walk within the radius of those propeller blades. If one of those things ever kicks in, it can slice off your arm or cut you in half. Yes, sir, Indy mumbled. They climbed aboard. Indy listened to Fulwa reading off the checklist. They set instruments before starting, adjusted the altimeter to the field elevation, then nodded to one another. Brakes locked. Controls free. Propellers clear. Indy, go back and check door lock security, Fulwa directed. Tarkis closed it. I heard. You want to do more than fly, my friend. Fulwa smiled. You want to operate this machine. Check the door. Indy disappeared, came back with a nod of his head. Done. While we did the walk around, did you check the security locks on the underwing lockers? Why, I didn't. I know. I did, Fulwa scolded gently. You do it by the book, Indy, and you learn to memorize everything. Now, we'll taxi out. I'll work the radios, Will, he told Cromwell, then turned again to Indy. Notice how he keeps the yoke full back when we taxi. This keeps the tail down and gives us better control on the ground. And while we taxi, we'll keep checking the gauges as the engines warm up. They stopped well short of the active runway. Another checklist, another litany of shouted calls and checks and rechecks. They ran the engines to full power until the Ford rattled and shook as if it had palsy. Both Cromwell and Fulwa turned to grin at Indy. You remembering everything? Huh? Oh, sure, Indy said hastily. There's a great American saying, my friend. Cromwell laughed. In a pig's eye, you are. But you'll learn. Now, we'll break a rule. You should be strapped into a seat, but being the magnificent pilot I am, he showed a broad toothy smile, we'll let you stand where you are. Get a good grip on the seat backs and don't touch anything that moves. Got it? Got it, Indy told him. You're clear to the active and for takeoff, Fulwa told Cromwell. The Briton worked the outboard engine, tapping the brakes gently, and lined up the airplane on the runway center line. He moved all the controls again to their limits, held the yoke full back, adjusted the friction knobs for the throttles, and nodded to Fulwa. Ready? Like a French goose, Fulwa told him. Cromwell held full pressure on the brakes, and moved the throttle steadily forward to their stops, the propellers screaming. He scanned the gauges, nodded to himself, and released the brakes. The Ford surged ahead, howling. Almost at once the tail came up and Indy had a clear view of the runway. Cromwell held in right rudder pressure to keep the Ford tracking true, the speed building up swiftly. In less than 400 feet the main wheels were off the runway, and Indy looked around to see the ground fall away. It didn't. Engines and props howling, the Ford tore down the runway barely above the concrete, building its speed steadily. The grin on Cromwell's face told Indy more than enough. These guys were going to pull a surprise on him. Unknown to them, he'd read the pilot's operating handbook on this airplane, and he knew that even with a full load it was flying and climbing very well, even as slow as 80 miles an hour. He saw the gauge needle on the airspeed indicator tremble at 100, and it kept right on moving around as the runway end rushed at them. And it's upsy-daisy, Cromwell sang out as he hauled the yoke back suddenly. Indy was already braced, but he was still surprised and delighted as the Bold Lady trimotor lunged skyward in a wild climb, and then seemed to hang vertically as Cromwell racked her over in a steep bank. The three men were laughing and whooping it up together. Indy glanced back into the cabin where Gale had a grin from ear to ear, and Tarkis showed a face turning green as his stomach tried desperately to flee his body. I'm going to learn to fly this thing myself, Indy swore. There wasn't time for anything else but their checkout schedule. Once in the restricted airspace reserved for them, Tarkis staggered back to the circular container near the cabin rear. He pulled back and locked the sliding hatch atop the fuselage, then turned a crank handle that lifted the machine gun mount and the weapon into the airstream. Lying flat against the fuselage was a panel of curving armor glass. Tarkis pushed this upward and locked it into place with folding metal braces. Now he had a buffer against the powerful winds of flight. He released the securing pins of the machine gun, slid a heavy round canister with 200 rounds of ammunition, and shouted at the top of his lungs, "Give me something to kill. It makes better my stomach." Gale went back, tugged at his sleeve, and handed him a leather helmet with earphones and a mic within the helmet, so he would be on intercom. "Just hang in there and enjoy the scenery, old chap," Cromwell instructed him. "You'll get your chance to play with your new toy." "Hurry up," growled Tarkis. Fulwa pointed out their objective, a wide plain of several thousand acres. A huge circle had been painted on the ground and in its center was a small cluster of buildings. "That's our target," Indy announced. "Let's see you two mugs tear it up." Without hesitation, hurling Indy's body against the entrance side to the cockpit, Cromwell slammed the Ford into a wing-high rollover, coming back on the yoke, rolling in full left aileron, stamping left rudder, and shoving the throttles full forward. He kept his controls moving, as the trimotor swung up and around to peel off for the ground, and the next moment their speed went right through the gauge's reading of 150 miles per hour. It was a breathless rush earthward at a terrifying angle. Cromwell seemed like a madman intent on reaching the ground in the shortest possible time. Indy noticed what he'd failed to see before, a vertical line with crosshairs marked on the windshield. "Damn it, Will," Fulwa shouted, "what's the red line on this thing?" Red line," thought Indy furiously. "Of course, that's what they call, never exceed, speed. I think it's about 140 or something. But we're already doing 160 n. I don't know, and I bloody well don't care," Cromwell shouted back to the Frenchman. "You can't hurt this thing and you know it. Now shut the devil up and get with the systems." Guns charged. Charged. Tank jettison armed. Armed. "What the blazes are you going to do?" Indy shouted. "Drop our fuel tanks." Cromwell glanced about for only a moment. "Yahoo!" he shouted in a very unmannerly British war yell. He brought the nose of the Ford up slightly, eased in right rudder to line up his sight markings, and the next moment depressed the button on his yoke. The airplane vibrated and shook from nose to tail as the two-wing machine guns roared. Fountains of dirt leaped up along the ground, and then boards splintered and shattered as Cromwell fired dead center into the target buildings. He pulled out of the dive perilously close to the ground, and with their speed still high, hung the Ford on its wingtip in a screaming vertical turn. "Tarkis. Your turn. Get the center building." They heard the machine gun in back firing in staccato bursts, the wind backdraft bringing acrid gunpowder to their nostrils. Above the screaming wind, howling engines and propellers, and firing gun, they heard a terrible strangling noise. "What's going on back there?" Cromwell called to Gale. She could hardly speak. She seemed to be choking. Indy rushed back, staggering from side to side of the cabin through the wild ride, the hammering gun, and thundering bedlam. Gale grabbed Indy close, spoke into his ear. "It's our hero. Tarkis. He's throwing up out there." She was convulsed with laughter. Swept up in the rush of emotion, she grabbed Indy's waist to hug him fiercely. Their eyes caught and held. For the instant they might have been alone on a mountaintop. Impulsively Gale's hands swept up, grasped Indy's head, and kissed him fiercely. He was astonished. He still held her tightly, wide-eyed. "This is marvelous," she shouted. "Let's go forward and see how Tarkis did." Holding on to one another they pushed into the cockpit deck. Fulwa pointed to the center building. "He is a superb marksman," Fulwa remarked, as calmly as if drinking tea on some quiet veranda. "In America, I suppose you would call him Deadeye Dick. He is really very good." "Renee, I'm going to sling those tanks into the buildings," Cromwell announced to the Frenchman in the right seat. "As soon as I do that, you've got the controls. Bring her around in a climbing turn and then see if you can put those rockets where they'll do the most good. Righto, cheerio, and what for, eh? Fulwa mimicked his friend. Have at it. The Ford came around with diminishing speed, control and accuracy were everything now. Cromwell held the trimotor straight and true as Fulwa held his hand on the emergency release cable handle. On my mark, shouted Cromwell. A moment later he sang out, 3, 2, 1. Mark. They felt a jolt as the tanks were ejected by powerful coiled springs. Cromwell brought the Ford up in a high swinging chandelle, close to stalling speed at the top of the curving climb, with the left wing down so they could all see the two tanks tumbling as they crashed into the buildings. A white mist leaped into being as the tanks ruptured. Bingo, Indy shouted his congratulations. You've got her, Cromwell called to Fulwa. The Englishman held aloft both hands and clapped them together in the traditional handing over of control. There wasn't a nudge to the airplane as Fulwa took the controls. He brought down the nose, swept about in a wide turn, and eased into a shallow dive. I'm going for 130, he announced to Cromwell. Call out the speeds. 140, coming down, 135, and, that's it, 130 on the nose. Fulwa nudged the throttles as if stroking a woman's hand, and the airspeed needle pegged on 130. Fulwa's voice was calm and cool as if he might be talking about a soccer game or ordering a drink at a Paris club. Confirm rocket release doors open. Cromwell looked up at the wings, the covering panels had slid away. Doors open, electrical primers armed. Very good. Thank you. Indy nudged Gale. I think he's got ice water in his veins. Gale was too excited to talk. She clung to Indy's arm, eyes wide, immersed in the moment. Just about time, and, fire, Fulwa said calmly, pressing the button. Two rockets from their rails ejected flame and smoke behind them, racing earthward toward the buildings, squiggling like tadpoles as they arrowed ahead of the trimotor. They struck with spouts of flame, and then the gasoline vapors ignited with a huge fireball leaping upward, a boiling mass of flames and smoke. Fulwa already had gone to full power and racked the trimotor about on its right wing, climbing away from the rising fireball. Safely out of range he swung back again to the left. You're hired, Indy told him, slapping him on the shoulder. The buildings were flattened, burning fiercely. That's it, Indy added. Cromwell glanced at Fulwa. Take her up to 4,000. It's time for the school bell to ring. Fulwa leveled off at 4,000 feet and set the power to cruise. Behind them Tarkis had lowered the gun mount and closed the hatch, reducing the howl of wind and engine roar from outside. Cromwell climbed from the left seat. Who's first? He asked Indy and Gale. Ladies first, Indy said. I'll watch her, and then I'll give it a try. Gale climbed into the left seat, fastened the seatbelt, and let her fingers run lightly over the yoke. Now, all I want you to do is hold our present course, Renee said soothingly. You can follow that road ahead of us. If you pick a point on the horizon, just aim for it. Make all your control inputs gently. And don't worry about a thing. I'll be riding the controls with you. I'm sure you'll do fine. Gale hadn't said a word. Fulwa held up both hands in the time-honored signal. You've got it, he told Gale. They all expected wandering, the nose rising and falling, swinging a bit to left or right. It didn't happen. Indy stared with growing disbelief as the Ford flew on as though it was on steel rails. Cromwell and Fulwa exchanged glances. I'll be hanged, Cromwell said finally. She knows how. Indy leaned forward, watching everything Gale did. His face mirrored disbelief and no small awe at the woman, her red hair flying in the wind from the open side window. Finally he tapped her shoulder. You really can fly, he said with masterful understatement. Why in thunder didn't you tell me? She glanced back at Indy, her eyes gleaming, loving his surprise. No one ever asked me, she said. Cromwell pushed next to Indy so he could talk to Gale. Miss Parker, you're no novice. Thank you, she said, exasperating the three men all the more. When? Cromwell barked. I mean, when did you learn? When I was 12, I spent a summer in Germany with some cousins. They were all mad about gliding, and I joined them. I had 3 months of flying gliders almost every day. Did you solo? Fulwa asked. Second week, she said with a straight face. And after that? Cromwell pressed. Scotland. More gliders, then an old training plane. My mother had the money, and I spent another summer at a flying school up there. I suppose you flew solo in powered machines? Asked Cromwell. Yes. Well, will you get to the bleeding point, Miss Parker? Do you have your certificate? She turned again with the smile of a lynx. Single engine, multi-engine, commercial privileges. I'll be hanged, Cromwell said quietly. Indy, do you want to give it a go now? Gale asked the perplexed man behind her. Let's let it wait until tomorrow, Fulwa broke in. I have the field in sight. Not enough time left for now. All right, Gale, I'll take it from here. She kept her left hand on the yoke and began easing back the throttles to start their descent toward the airfield. Why? She asked. Well, it's obvious, I mean, ah, he faltered. Why don't you work the radio? She asked sweetly. Indy seemed to have a thundercloud over his head. Sure, you work the radio, Renee, he said in clipped tones. He couldn't believe this. She was going to try to land this thing, her first time on the controls. She brought the Ford down in a perfect three-point landing. She taxied off the runway onto the long taxiway back to their hangar. Would you mind taking it from here? She asked Fulwa as she started from her seat. Oh. Yes, of course, thank you, he said, feeling like an idiot. She squeezed past Indy, close enough to brush his lips with hers as she went by. Excuse me, Indy. I need to fix my hair. End of chapter. Editor's note. In the event that this book has been posted at another location, please note that this audiobook was created by YouTube channel, YJK Audiobooks. Please visit our YouTube channel for other exciting stories. Also, if you are enjoying this audiobook, please consider supporting the expense of our projects through our Patreon page. Those who do so have access to exclusive book series, are able to download the MP3 files for all books we create, and also have early access to our normal YouTube releases. For more details, please visit patreon.com/YJK Audiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and now, back to the story. Chapter 10. Indy stood before the door to Cromwell's room. He raised a fist, hesitated, then slammed his fist against the door. He heard a startled, "Good God, are the Huns attacking?" as Cromwell burst from a deep sleep. The next moment a loud crash ensued from the room, as Cromwell lurched from his bed and fell over his boots. Indy pushed open the door, staring down at Cromwell with his face pushed into the floor. Indy grasped his arm and hauled the portly Britisher to his feet. Do you know what time it is, Will? Do you remember what we're supposed to do first thing this morning? Did you arrange for the plane to be ready? Indy hurled a barrage of questions at the befuddled pilot, still trying to shake cobwebs from his brain. No. What time is it? He mumbled. It's already 5:30, man. 5:30? What are you doing up at this ungodly hour? You're going to teach me to fly this morning, you nit. Wake up. I'm trying. Maybe this is just a bad dream. Go away, Indy. Indy shook life into the sagging body. 10 minutes, Brigadier. See you in the mess. Indy stomped into the dining mess, poured a mug of steaming coffee, and slumped into a chair at the table. Fulwa studied him carefully. "Someone left some hot coals in place of your eyeballs, Indy." Indy grunted, sipping coffee. "Studied most of the night. All fired up to get at the controls, no?" "Something wrong with that," Indy challenged. "Perish the thought. I admire your spirit. Where's Colonel Blimp?" Cromwell slouched into the room, wobbled before the coffee urn, filled his mug, and dragged himself to the table. He eased into a chair. "I tried your guaranteed, money refunded, can't miss wake-up system, Professor Jones." "I would like to hear what that is," Fulwa said. Cromwell looked at the Frenchman. He started, pointing at Indy, said the way to come awake is to stand bloody naked in the toilet bowl and pour hot coffee over your head. "I tried it. My scalp is scalded, the hair is burned off my chest, and not a drop made it down to my feet. The only problem is that while it is somewhat agonizing, it doesn't wake you up. It just sent me rushing into a cold shower." Indy nodded to Fulwa. "See? It works." He turned back to Cromwell. "Drink coffee. Eat if you can. Then we fly." "Ah, but you are to be disappointed," Fulwa said with a gesture of defeat. "Not today, mon ami. Have you looked upon the world outside?" Indy stomped into the hangar and headed for a window. Before he reached it, he knew the bad news. A hissing roar, a sudden flash of light, and a deafening crack of thunder from the lightning bolt. At the window he stared at a monsoon-like downpour. He stomped back into the mess. "All right," he said grimly to Cromwell, "we'll do ground school then." "Not with me, bucko," Cromwell deferred. "I've got a schedule to keep with our Iron Bird. But first I'm going to get some more sleep. Then I'll fill in the missing items we should have put on our checklist."
"Like what?" Indy demanded.
"For starters, parachutes," Cromwell said.
"Life jackets," Fulwa added.
"Survival rations," Cromwell chipped in.
"Never mind. We'll take care of it. I'm sure Miss Parker, now identified as our secret ace flyer, can teach you some of the salient points of aeronautics."
Colonel Henshaw joined them in the midst of their exchange. He held his coffee mug to warm his hands.
"No schoolwork for you today, Indy."
"Schoolwork? Is that what you call flight training?"
"Every bird must be dumped from its nest, Professor."
Cromwell smiled.
"We all went through it, Indy," Henshaw said to mollify the obviously disgruntled Jones.
"I know I did when I was a flight cadet." Indy glared at the group.
"Does everyone around here fly except me?"
Tarkies lifted his head from the next table where he seemed to have been sound asleep.
"Indy, my good friend.
You, me, we are only two sane people here. We leave flying to the birds and the crazies."
"Sensible, no.
Allah wants us to fly, we would have airline tickets from heaven."
Fulwa looked at Balem with surprised respect.
"And I always thought the mountain man was a humorless clod."
Indy waved them to silence.
"Harry, what's up?"
"Coded message."
The quiet hung in the room.
A coded message and Henshaw's unexpected appearance meant something heavy had come upon them.
"The prefix is notification of a yet unspecified action," Henshaw continued.
"Some travel, it appears.
That's simply to alert us."
"I mean, you.
And?
We're decoding the full message.
Finish your coffee.
We have at least 20 minutes.
Who's it from, Harry?
First I need to know your handle."
Eyes locked on Henshaw, then turned to Indy.
"No offense," Henshaw said quickly.
"Those are your rules."
Indy smiled.
"Very good, Harry."
He had set up the system with Treadwell. He wrote the coded handle on a slip of paper and handed it to the army officer.
Henshaw read, "Lone Ranger."
"Thank you."
20 minutes later they were in the message center. A sergeant handed the decoded sheet to Henshaw, who glanced at the name on top and in turn gave it to Indy. Must see you in person. Soonest possible face-to-face meeting, imperative. We have received offer from the Pan-Arab Archaeological Institute of Jordan to sell us an extremely rare artifact. Description is cube, metallic origin, unknown, undeciphered cuneiform markings, 3 by 3 inches. Your judgment required. Future action requires your presence before we respond. Advise ASAP with travel plans. St. Joseph. Indy gave the paper to Henshaw. He read it quickly, then looked up with a puzzled expression. St. Joseph? That St. Joseph of Copertino. A monk who could levitate. It's the handle for Castellano. He's one of us. Henshaw was wide-eyed. Sure is. Harry, they want me there now. I want Gale along as another set of eyes, with Tarkies for backup. How long will it take the Ford to make it to New York? That seems like the fastest way. No dice, Indy. Even the birds are walking. That weather front, and it's a mean one, has stalled out over this area. I can get you 2 compartments on the Silver Streak special. Fastest train in the country. It leaves this afternoon and you'll be in New York tomorrow morning. I can also have private transportation arranged. I'll have the details ready for you in an hour. Indy nodded. Thanks. Do it. You, Indy said through gritted teeth, are sleeping with me. Gale responded with a joke. Do I take that as an order or an invitation? You know what I mean, Indy snapped back. I don't want you sleeping alone. So I gathered. But your technique is somewhat Stone Age, just in case you're interested. Confound it, woman, I'm not asking you to sleep with me. Gale studied her nails. You could have fooled me. With me too, Tarkies grunted. Sound like invitation to. Shut up, Indy snarled, stabbing a finger at Tarkies. He turned back to Gale. You are not going to sleep alone in a compartment on this train. Take that as an order if you want. You'll sleep in one bunk and I'll sleep in the other. We have a direct telephone connection with compartment E right next door where Tarkies will be staying. We can be in touch with each other at any time. Do I make myself clear now? You disappoint me, Professor, Gale said lightly, but, yes, I get your drift. We'll stay out here in the passageway while you do whatever you do at night, Indy told her. When you're ready, open the door. If you don't open it in 5 minutes, we'll break our way in. She studied him carefully, the teasing gone from her words and her expression. You really are concerned, she said softly. He nodded. By now she could recognize the signs on his face, the slight furrowing of the brow, his heightened tension. It's more than a sixth sense, my God, he knows we're vulnerable. He's expecting something bad tonight. All right, she told him quietly. Whatever you say. I don't need to be in the compartment alone. She swiftly drew a conclusion. I'm sleeping in my clothes. Indy seemed relieved. Good. Tarkies, you all set? The Kurd nodded. He waited until Indy and Gale had closed their door behind them, then switched the nameplates on their door, with that from his own. He slipped into his compartment, and tried the telephone line to confirm its working. Then he tied a string about his own door latch, at the end of which was a small prayer bell. Its sound was barely audible, but to the man who had prayed all his life to the sound of that bell, it would serve as an instant alert to any movement of the door latch. He smiled. Shortly after 3 in the morning, the train rolling steadily through the stormy night, he heard the whispered sound of his prayer bell. Immediately he moved to one side of the door, just before it opened smoothly. In the gloom he made out 2 forms. The moment the door closed behind them, Tarkies flung his net, studded with fishhooks, over their bodies. Shouts and cries of pain answered the hard yank he gave to the net, sending barbs into flesh. Tarkies moved swiftly with a flexible metal rod, bringing it down with terrible force. He turned for a moment, and shoved open the compartment window. Above the yelps of pain and cursing from the men struggling within the net, he heard pounding on the door. He shouted, "I be right there. I." A knife blade stabbed into his leg, a white fire of pain. Tarkis ignored the wound as one man freed himself from the net, looming before Tarkis with the knife stabbing downward. It never reached the maddened Kurd. A single sideswipe with the metal rod smashed the knife into the wall. Indy kicked open the door, the Webley in his hand, just in time to see Tarkis heaving his attacker through the opened window space. In an instant he was gone, the train speeding onward. He turned to see the other assassin bringing down a curved blade. Indy was already there, smashing the barrel of the Webley across the man's wrist. Bone cracked audibly, and the man screamed. Tarkis spun about, but as he grabbed for the man his wounded leg gave way and he fell to all fours. Indy moved forward, grasped a handful of hair and the belt of the killer, and hurled the man through the window. Gale slipped past Indy and snapped on the lights. In a moment she took in the bloody leg. "Tear me some bandages from the sheets," she ordered Indy. She helped Tarkis to his bunk. "Your whiskey." Quickly, she told him. "Whiskey? I do not." "Shut up and give me the flask," she snapped. Silently, he handed her the flask from his pocket. She put it onto the bunk, soaked a towel in the sink, and washed away the blood. Indy had already tied a tourniquet above the wound. Gale opened the flask and poured whiskey into the wound to sterilize the exposed flesh, then wrapped the makeshift bandages about the wound. "Only woman would waste good whiskey," Tarkis complained. But his eyes showed his gratitude. "So you changed the nameplates?" Tarkis nodded. "It worked, no. You have any idea who they were?" "Brown skin. One had turban. That means they were professional assassins. Somebody not like you, Indy." "Yeah. I must have missed out on the popularity contest. By the way, that's a neat trick with that net of yours." Tarkis beamed through his pain. "Old Roman trick. Very old. Also popular with mafia." "With me too," Gale added. "Well, the lock on your door is gone," Indy observed. "You'd better stay with us the rest of the night." "No need. I sit here on bunk so I can see door." He reached behind his back, and withdrew a sleek .32 automatic from a concealed holster. "Besides, Gale is good woman. She does not waste all my whiskey. Sometimes I like to drink alone. Good night." "Gale, take the upper berth." She climbed up and sat cross-legged. "How did those people know who we were, where we were on this train, when we'd be here?" He smiled. "You haven't figured there's a big fat leak in our security?" "I have now," she said angrily. "Any ideas?" "Some," he shrugged. "I'm working on it." "But why would they want to kill you?" "Us," he reminded her. She shuddered. "They'd have to kill you also," he went on, checking the Webley. "We're a team. If they don't get you, they could be identified later. So, you're also a target." "You still didn't say why they want to kill you." "Us," she amended. "Tomorrow. You expect a lot tomorrow." He nodded. "Indy, you can't go around New York with that cannon hanging from your belt." "I know." He was already removing the Webley from the belt holster to slip it into an underarm holster. Abruptly he slammed a fist into his hand. "Sometimes I feel like an idiot. I've been carrying that thing loaded and ready to shoot, and I never took any pictures when I had the chance. Those people in Tarkis' room, I mean. That's bothering you? You didn't take pictures. Just saving our lives wasn't enough. You're upset because you didn't use your camera. That's what cameras are for." She sighed. "Good night, Indy."
He heard a muttered, "Good grief."
They moved through Pennsylvania Station in the midst of the early morning crowd rush. Normally, Indy disliked being shuffled along with cattle herds of people, but this time it served his purpose by swallowing up his group of three. Indy and Gale walked together, Tarkies several steps behind them, maintaining their pace despite a swollen leg and a painful limp. They departed the station on the north side, where a long line of taxicabs queued up. Indy saw what he wanted across the street, a yellow cab, with the number 294 on its side. He nodded to Tarkies.
"That one's ours.
His sign says he's taken," Gale noticed.
"He is.
By us," Indy said in clipped tones. The driver leaned back and opened their door. Inside, they took stock of the man in the front seat. He was a huge black fellow with a heavy beard and dark glasses that concealed his eyes, and he spoke with a melodious British accent.
"Welcome to New York," he said with a hearty laugh.
Gale nudged Indy and mouthed the word Jamaica. He nodded. The big man before them adjusted his rearview mirror.
"You are right, miss.
Jamaica it is." Laughter greeted her expression of surprise.
"I do not read minds, Miss Parker.
I read lips very well."
"And you know my name," Gale said cautiously.
"But of course," came the reply. "Yours, and that of Professor Jones, and that very ugly fellow with the strange name of Tarkies Bolem."
"Ugly with a strange name.
His mother must not have liked him very much." Tarkies started forward. Indy motioned for him to sit quietly. Whoever this man was, he was incredibly cocky and self-confident.
"You were sent, no doubt, by the man from Copertino," Indy offered, referring to the coded message Henshaw had given him.
White teeth flashed, in a wider smile.
"St. Joseph has assigned me to your good health and needs.
My name is Jocko Killarney.
While you are in New York, I am your guide, your friend, your driver, and your protector."
Indy felt right about this man. He was big and he was powerful, and even under his shirt musculature rippled across huge shoulders. Indy would have bet a dollar to a dime he also knew his way about the sordid underworld of this city.
"By the way, Professor, your man, this big ugly fellow with you, he is really very good," said the driver.
"Sometime this morning two bodies were found along the railroad tracks over which your train brought you here. Before you find the need to ask, Professor, they were both quite dead, and neither body had any identification. The police will simply dispose of the bodies in Potter's Field."
"What's that?" Gale whispered.
"Cemetery for the unknown and unwanted," Indy said to Gale. He directed his attention to the driver.
"Any connections of any kind?"
"Nobody knows anything, Mon, and you may forget about anyone claiming those two." He turned to look at Indy and Tarkies.
"That was quite a technique.
I admire efficiency.
A net studded with fishhooks.
Very original." He started the engine and depressed the clutch to shift into first gear. Indy felt pressure from Tarkies' hand, a signal.
Indy nodded.
The big man was still steaming from Killarney's playful insults, and Indy decided to let him have his head.
"Hey, you fellow, Jocko," Tarkies called out.
"What may I do for you, goat keeper?"
"You listen to me, Black Irish, maybe you live longer.
Do I hear the voodoo drums, llama man?
Soon you no more here.
You listen good.
There is deadly snake in front of cab with you.
Little snake was in my bag, somehow get out.
Back home we call snake, a two-step.
Nice name, huh?"
Tarkies offered a wide toothy grin to Jocko.
"Snake bite man, he take one step, feel bad.
Take two step, he fall down dead.
No antidote.
If you do not get out of cab right now, snake going to bite you, and we send home your head in basket."
Jocko looked about warily, then his eyes grew huge as a bright yellow and orange snake wriggled toward his foot. In a flash he had his door open and stood in the street several feet from the taxi.
"You crazy,
Mon, he shouted. Indy and Gale leaned forward, ready to abandon the cab if necessary.
Good God, it's really there, Gale said in a hoarse voice.
She stared in disbelief as Tarkis leaned into the front of the cab and snatched up the snake. He petted it gently along its back and dropped it into a side pocket of his jacket.
Gale screeched and threw her arms about Indy.
Get it out of here, she yelled.
It's his pet, Indy answered.
I can't do that.
Get it out.
She buried her head in his chest.
Indy patted her gently on her shoulder.
No need to worry, Gale. Once he has the snake in his pocket, it's harmless.
He met Tarki's eyes and the two winked at one another.
In his quick glance, Indy had seen what the others missed.
The snake was a beautifully articulated wood or metal mechanical device, with a real snakeskin covering the body, and nasty fangs for good measure, in the gaping mouth. But Indy knew snakes, had dealt with them even though they gave him the creeps, and just the way this creature moved heightened his suspicions, all confirmed by the way Tarkis smiled triumphantly, as he dropped the kill in two-step snake into his pocket.
Jocko, tense from anger in his open showing of fright, returned to the cab and stabbed a finger at Tarkis.
You and I, dung heap, we got unfinished business.
Tarkis guffawed.
I not worry about man who is frightened like little girl by worm.
Indy leaned forward to tap Jocko gently on the shoulder.
Straight to the museum, my Irish muse, and no more detours or stops, got it.
Jocko turned around, pointed a finger at Indy, and snapped his thumb forward like a firing pin, closing on a round.
Gotcha, boss.
Chapter 11. The American Museum of Natural History, sprawled over several city blocks, from its entrance at Central Park West and 79th Street in Manhattan. As impressive as were the museums Indy and Gale had visited elsewhere, this structure and its vast and complex interior stood in a class by itself.
It seemed to go on forever.
Hundreds of exhibit rooms and huge halls, some 30 to 50 feet in height, accommodated dozens of fauna from throughout the world, including such creatures of monstrous size as the great blue whale. To stand in a room and look upward at the preserved specimen of the largest creature that ever existed on the planet, itself surrounded by dozens of other specimens large and small, was an overwhelming sight. Throughout the museum were literally hundreds of thousands of life forms.
Gale walked with Indy and Tarkis down long corridors through just a small part of the museum to a private area several stories below ground level.
Her eyes moved constantly.
This is incredible, she said with unabashed awe at the exhibits about them.
I could stay in the Egyptian archives for a month.
They have a worldwide exchange program, Indy acknowledged.
They trade off with institutions from just about everywhere.
And it helps that this museum, or its foundation, is sponsored by some very wealthy people.
There's a lot about this country that needs improvement, just like anywhere else in the world, but this place, he spread wide his arms as if to encompass the magnificent structure, well, it's one of the finest statements ever made about people trying to understand his world.
Jocko Killarney, leading the way, turned to Indy.
Professor, I've never heard it said better.
In fact, you've done field research for the Foundation, haven't you?
I have the idea you already know every step I've taken for the Foundation, Indy said wryly.
Jocko shrugged.
I meant the compliment, sir, most sincerely.
You're a man of many different faces, Jocko, Gale told him.
Jocko replied with a smile and a brief bow.
We will take the elevator at the end of this hallway, he said.
They stopped by elevator doors with a large red sign that said, Freight only, no passengers.
I guess we come under the heading of freight, Indy noted.
Consider yourself valuable cargo, Jocko said lightly.
The doors opened, and they were soon on their way to a third-level sub-basement.
They emerged from a sloping corridor to a surprisingly large domed area.
Gale stopped short, looking about her with surprise and wonder.
They seemed to be in the middle of a northern forest, trees looming about them, rocks, slopes and even a brook gurgling unseen within the heavy growth.
Gale froze as a tree branch moved aside and a huge brown bear rose to its feet and roared. Immediately Tarkis shoved her aside, placing himself between her and the bear. His automatic, pitiful as it was against the enormous animal bulk, was in his hand. Then another bear emerged through bushes, this one on all fours. Suddenly it reared high, the deadly Kodiak, largest bear in the world.
"Put away the gun," Indy told Tarkis.
"But
it's a diorama," Indy told him.
"It is big damned bear," Tarkis shouted.
"Ah, but this bear, and all the others," Jocko broke in, "are very dead."
"Dead bears do not walk and roar," Tarkis grated.
"They're mechanical inside," Indy said to Tarkis, gently pushing down his arm and the weapon.
"Apparently this is where they set up the dioramas, that's a duplicate of the real world, before they move the display upstairs for the public."
"You mean," Tarkis said, wide-eyed, "these are like big toys."
"Sure," Jocko told him. "Electricity runs their mechanical systems."
He laughed.
"Like a player piano."
Indy wanted as little as possible to do with meetings. He felt stifled, hemmed in.
"Best to get this one over with as quickly as possible.
Jocko, let's keep it moving."
"Yes, sir."
Jocko led them down another corridor and through a set of double doors, where a group of people watched their entrance. Filippo Castellano rose from a table to greet them. Gale took note that Indy obviously knew this man well. Her eyes swept the group, she recognized Yoshiro Matsuda from the gathering in Ohio. Rashid Quahira had been known to her from Egypt, long before the Ohio meeting. She turned to Indy, and saw him studying a striking woman at the table's far end. At the same time she realized Indy was working the concealed wire lead camera trigger, the Leica was clicking away as Indy turned his body to capture everyone present on film. He stepped aside to let Gale pass him, and from the corner of her eye she saw the deft movement as he replaced the leather cover to the camera. Indy locked his gaze with that of the woman. Castellano introduced her.
"It is my pleasure," he told Indy.
"This is Madame Marcia Mason."
Indy greeted her with a murmured, "My pleasure, madam," and in return he received a nod and a study of himself from the woman. She had a powerful presence. Indy could almost feel her strength, yet he judged her name to be a false identity. He took in her severe yet striking features and dark hair. She was elegant in dress and presentation, and held herself with a confidence that came only with an athletic, hard-muscled background. Intelligent, tough, and accustomed to giving orders. Castellano had introduced her as from Denmark.
"That was so obviously untrue, my money is on Romania or Russia," Indy figured.
"And a double identity in this closed circle doesn't fit.
I'll have to watch this one carefully."
Indy took his seat, Gale and Tarkis arraying their chairs behind him. Castellano spoke to the group.
"May we get right to the matter at hand?"
Murmurs of agreement met his offer, and he looked directly at Indy.
"We know about last night," Castellano said.
"Word travels fast," thought Indy, but his face showed no idea of what he was thinking. He'd already made his decision to play this scene as easily and as quickly as he could.
He shrugged.
"It wasn't the first time," he said in reply.
"Ah," that struck a chord.
Marcia Mason had leaned forward, an easy movement that brought her the attention of the others.
"Perhaps you can tell us why such things are happening to you, Professor Jones."
"I, for one, fail to understand.
I'm a thorn in the side of the people we're trying to identify and to locate, Miss Mason. They have the idea that if they dispose of me, well, then they can continue their game unhindered."
"Is your presence so important to them?" The woman came back smoothly. It was as much a put-down as a question.
Filippo Castellano glanced at Merlin Frank, the real power behind the museum.
Castellano spoke quickly to head off what could become an unpleasant exchange between Indy and the woman.
"Mr. Frank, do you have any conclusions on this matter? Any further news as to what we're up against?"
Merlin Frank didn't smile, which told Indy that he was in at least partial agreement with Marcia Mason.
I confess, he said slowly, that some people are of the belief that Professor Jones has created a furor about himself, in order to give him carte blanche in his, well, his investigative process.
Dr. Frank, you're mincing words. If there's a criticism of what I'm doing, or how I'm doing it, just come right out with it.
Frank nodded, sighing with some inner regret. He and Indy had worked on projects long before this meeting and he wanted to maintain the excellent relationship between them. Yet, now he felt he had no choice but to be blunt.
We have been told, Professor Jones, that the incidents of personal attacks against you might never have taken place. That you have told us these stories for some reason which, I confess, I myself can't fathom.
Indy resisted a sharp answer. Frank meant well, that was what counted. He was simply in an unpleasant position.
Sir, I can't be responsible for what people tell you. I don't even care to know who they are, but I will say that whatever you heard, it wasn't from those men on the train.
The old saying still fits, dead men tell no tales.
Frank sighed again.
Professor Jones, there are members of our group who have difficulty with this evil empire we've been told about. The consortium supporting your, activities, now has grave doubts about such an organization.
Fair enough, Indy said.
What do they believe?
That the evil empire as an entity is simply a front, and that none of us really have hard facts about what's going on.
Hard facts.
Indy took a tight grip on himself not to offer a sharp retort to Frank.
What happened in South Africa, the train wrecks and slaughter, those are facts.
The flying boat, the Empress Kali, those are facts.
Castellano gestured for attention.
There is more, Dr. Frank. We are still trying to sort out the details, but two more ships have been raided and sunk.
There was an assault deep within Russia and a collection, priceless, of crown jewels stolen.
But the strangest of all is that a member of our group has been contacted by a source that remains, for now at least, nameless.
They want to sell us that mysterious artifact that was stolen in the flying boat attack.
A question, please, Indy said quickly.
Of course.
How did this unidentified source know that we were a group? Indy smiled.
Before you answer, would I be wrong in assuming they're asking a very high price for the cube?
Letting this group believe that the artifact is not from this world?
Frank eased into a more personal exchange with Indy by dropping his formal title.
Indy, if this artifact is as described, then it is beyond any price.
Does anyone here have a number? Indy pressed.
$1 billion, Frank said tersely.
Would you pay it? Indy asked.
Frank never hesitated.
Absolutely.
Sitting to his right, Gail Parker was more confused than she'd been since this meeting started. She already knew that Indy had set up the mock artifact in the Milledgeville train robbery, and now he was acting as if he believed the artifacts were real.
Shut up and listen, she told herself.
Indy knows what he's doing.
All the money this group is amassing, Indy said.
What do they do with it?
Matsuda motioned to the others that he would reply.
Such funds buy weapons.
Tanks, bombers, submarines and so on.
But weapons are not enough.
With enough money you can buy loyalty.
You establish your own power factions within governments.
You control the press, you wield great propaganda, and you move into controlling industry.
Control the food supply of a country and you control the country.
I am of the opinion that this group is determined to wield control over international commerce as well as military power.
The old benevolent emperor routine, Indy responded.
Perhaps not so benevolent, Matsuda said.
Am I right in judging that all the people in the consortium behind us are not necessarily in agreement with each other? Indy asked.
That is to be expected, Castellano said stiffly.
We are fighting both great power and shadows.
And you're seriously considering paying as much as $1 billion for that so-called extraterrestrial artifact?
That is my position, Frank confirmed.
Indy's smile almost had the touch of canary feathers.
Let me save you $1 billion.
He reached into a pocket of his jacket.
In fact, make that $2 billion. He tossed a pyramid artifact onto the table where it bounced to a stop, and then produced a double of the cube artifact that had created such a furor. They were stunned. They passed the two objects about the table, handling them with unabashed reverence. Finally, Merlin Frank returned to the moment. How could you possibly have obtained these? And forgive me, Indy, but you seem cavalier about something for which men have died.
There aren't any artifacts from outer space, Indy said quietly.
Well, not these anyway. Could they be from some ancient culture on our world? Castellano queried.
Not a chance.
But how did you get these? Marcia Mason burst out.
Indy studied her carefully, but not to any greater extent than the others in the room.
Somewhere in this group there was a traitor. He'd been warned long before about that by Treadwell, but up to this moment no one had been able to point a finger with any confidence at anyone else. The woman's surprise as to his possession of the artifacts could be genuine, if she was faithful to the group.
Or it could be surprise as to how I got these, if she isn't, Indy mused.
I'm not getting anywhere fast. Castellano was openly agitated.
Indy, tell us. How did you get these?
I'm not going to tell you anything that our opponents don't already know, Indy said quickly.
Keep that in mind, please.
First, I have a contract with the De Beers Diamond Mines. It is their custom always to place something in their jewel shipments that is easier to trace than diamonds, which can be recut to any size or shape. In this case, we used the cube artifact. The cuneiform markings simply gave it more authenticity. Or led people to believe that. But the cube, and this pyramid, were manufactured in England. I don't know the alloys involved, that's out of my field. But it's very much a homegrown product. My contribution was the markings. Someone who gets hold of this, and also believes in its rarity and value, must try to use or sell it in some way. So it acts as a beacon.
Are you telling us that this group, whoever and whatever they are, Marcia Mason asked slowly and deliberately, are trying to sell us a fake that our own group, yourself, created?
Yes, ma'am.
But how could you?
I mean, why would you have us believe these things were of such tremendous value?
I never said they were of any monetary or historical value, Indy told the group, but looking at Mason.
Just about everybody else did that. Including the people who have committed the crimes we're trying to solve. The stories about these artifacts were so effective that the people who robbed De Beers and the others figured the artifacts were the most valuable of all.
But why try to kill you? Frank burst out.
Castellano laughed.
Professor Jones is a better teacher than he is a secret agent. He almost set up his own execution.
Once the group we are facing had determined these artifacts were spurious, they had to get rid of Jones and his associates before they could let the rest of us or other customers in the world know the things were worthless.
And they came very close to succeeding, Gail Parker spoke up suddenly.
There's another reason, Indy told the group.
He had their instant attention.
Our opposition has a plant among us.
A what?
We have a traitor in our midst, Indy said calmly.
For money, idealism, whatever.
But someone within this group, which includes those people not present at this meeting, works for our enemy.
That is a grave charge, Frank said, visibly disturbed.
Yes, sir, Indy agreed.
It is also true.
For several minutes, the conference room resounded to arguments, rising and falling in volume, and varying tones of anger and confusion. Indy had hoped this would follow his shocker of there being a traitor in their midst. Now, if Treadwell's own skills could be applied through Indy's next words, he might be able to rattle even more the cage of their unknown adversary. He waited until quiet returned to the group. They obviously hoped he might have more to tell them.
Indy did, but his purpose was to pass on a message to their opposition.
There is one other matter that needs clarification, he began. He had already caught them unawares, and knew he had their close attention.
Those flying machines, Indy said,
seemingly confused about the issue. "We haven't said a word about something the best aeronautical engineers in the world really can't explain. Discs, or saucers, or whatever they're called, flying at speeds that seem impossible. The mother ship, if that is really what it is, well, that's much easier to understand. It's sort of a super zeppelin. But we don't know what makes it go, do we?" Dr. Frank broke in.
"No, sir, we don't," Indy admitted.
"Let me change that, sir. I don't know what makes it go. I'm no pilot and I'm no engineer, but I do listen to the really sharp people in those lines. And they tell me the stories of those discs, or scimitars, coming from outer space. Well, as far as they're concerned, that's nonsense. In the face of what we've heard," Castellano said, "they still feel they're from right here, from Earth?"
"They sure do," Indy said. "I must beg to differ," Matsuda broke in.
"I do not say they are from other worlds, Professor Jones, but there is nothing known on this world that flies without wings, at 500 miles an hour, that can hover, or levitate. What they do is impossible by everything we know."
"I'm not arguing with you, sir," Indy said.
"I wouldn't do that. I tell you only what the experts tell me."
"Then your experts, Indy," Castellano followed Matsuda, "seem in need of better information. Our flying machines are helpless before these discs. There must be an explanation beyond the mere statement that they are of local origin."
"I agree. But I am explaining to you that the professionals in this field are convinced we are dealing with terrestrial vehicles, produced in a manner we can't yet explain, operated by a force we can't yet identify."
"No, I shouldn't say that. I don't get into the technical side of all this. They believe they either have the answers or they're about to get them."
"That should do it," Indy concluded to himself. "Whoever is on the side of the opposition is going to get back to them as fast as they can that their plan is starting to come unglued at the seams. I sure hope Henshaw and Treadwell are better at this than I am."
Indy rose to his feet.
"I have a lot to do, much to learn, and I'm racing a clock. I've also got some great help now. We may be closer to answers than any of you realize."
Gale and Tarkis also were standing. They didn't say a word. But their facial expressions and the manner in which they stood made it abundantly clear they were in full agreement with Indy. In the uncomfortable silence that followed, as one by one everyone else stood, Indy caught a fleeting glimpse of a workman, olive-skinned and in a turban, leaving through a rear side door. Just a glimpse and the man was gone. It should have meant nothing, but who would leave this incredible scene? Because if he were privy to listening to the exchange, he already had been judged as loyal to the group.
"You are really quite disturbing in what you say, Indy," Frank finally broke the ice.
"You have our continued full support," Matsuda assured him.
"And ours," said Castellano.
"I await further word, I must admit," Quahira smiled, with great anticipation.
Only Marcia Mason remained silent. Indy ignored her. He knew she would figure in his life soon enough. Without another word or a backward glance, he left the room, followed closely by Gale, Jocko, and Tarkis. Waiting for the elevator, Gale turned to Jocko.
"Could we go through that diorama again? I'd like another look at that. It gives me ideas for museum presentations."
Indy nodded. He was still thinking about that workman and the manner in which he'd left their conference room. They retraced their steps to the huge hall with the Northern Woods diorama. Indy was impressed. They'd even kept a wood scent present in the area. He looked up into the trees, and they were real trees, their roots in tubs concealed by brush. He was impatient to get back to his search. He turned to Gale.
"Seen enough?"
"Yes." Her eyes shone with pleasure. Suddenly her eyes widened.
"Indy," she gasped.
"The bear, look out." He heard the coughing roar from behind him. For just an instant, his senses triggered to the presence of danger, even though he realized where they were, and that the bears were electromechanical objects. The next moment, he was struck a powerful blow.
He felt as if he'd been hit by a charging rhino, and felt his body spinning about as he was hurled from his feet. He had a fleeting glimpse of Tarkis. The man had dashed full tilt into Indy to smash him aside. Indy shook his head to make sense of what was happening. Then he saw the huge Kodiak bear lunging forward and downward from its display position, its front paws with terrible claws unsheathed, swinging together as it came down. The great animal, fully 9 feet tall and weighing several hundred pounds, crashed into Tarkis, one paw slicing across his face with savage force. The claws laid the side of his head open to white bone. A ghastly gurgle rattled in the big man's throat as he toppled to the floor beneath the immense figure of the bear. Tarkis died instantly. Indy had already spun about. There. A flash of white, the white coat of the turbaned workman who'd slipped away from the conference room. If anyone would have worked the controls to send the mechanical animal rushing at Indy, it must have been him, and now he was trying to sneak away. Jocko was already running full speed to head off the man before he could disappear into the labyrinthine hallways and side rooms of the below-ground sections of the museum. Indy had his hand about the grip of the Webley, but before he, or Jocko, could stop the man, Gale had stepped forward, one arm held stiffly before her. Indy heard the sudden twang of metal under strain and a hissing sound. He saw a blur as something snapped across the room toward the flash of white. A moment later a muffled scream reached them and they heard the crash of a falling body against a floor. Indy turned to look at Gale. She had a strange smile on her face, a look of unexpected triumph. "Got him," she said quietly. "With what?" he asked. She pulled back her jacket sleeve. Indy stared at a circular bolt launcher fitted securely to her forearm. "Remember when I used the machine shop back at the airfield?" she asked. He nodded. "Notched bolt," she explained. "Fast as a crossbow." She smiled grimly. "Never mind how small it is. It's tipped with Kurarin. About 6 times deadlier than Kurari. He's paralyzed, and he won't live much longer." Indy was already running about the wide curve of the diorama. He came upon the man in the white jacket and turban on the floor, Jocko standing over him. "Don't kill him," Indy snapped. "I need some answers from him." "Too late, boss. I don't know what hit him, but his lungs and vocal cords are paralyzed. He won't last much." There wasn't any need to continue. Eyes bulging, tongue protruding, the man twitched violently, heels drumming on the floor. His head snapped back violently. They heard the crack of his neck breaking. "Let's get out of here, now," Indy ordered. "You're leaving 2 dead men behind," Jocko said unnecessarily. "Castellano will handle it. He's an old pro at getting rid of bodies." Gale had followed them and he grabbed her arm, half dragging her to a stairway. "Lead the way, Jocko." "Right to your cab," Indy snapped. "When we're driving, make sure we're not being followed, and then get us onto Long Island." They dashed up the stairways. Jocko went into the parking lot first, opened the cab's hood to check for any explosives, slipped beneath the cab to do the same, then signaled Indy and Gale to follow. Moments later, they were driving through Central Park. "I'll work us down to the 59th Street Bridge," Jocko said. "I know the back roads, and no one can follow us without my knowing about it." "Where to on the island?"
"Roosevelt Field."
"Our plane is already there," Indy told him. Gale studied Indy. "Any more surprises in your bag of tricks?" He nodded. "You'll see." End of part 5. This book will be released in segments each week on our YouTube channel, free of charge. However, to help support the costs involved in creating this audiobook, the entire book is available now to our Patreon supporters. If you would like to listen to the entire book early, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and remember to choose wisely.